We welcome everyone. It's good to see everyone who is here with us tonight. By way of announcements, you remember next Sunday morning we'll have baptism. First thing, Sunday morning, Sunday morning worship service. So that will take place. Of course, this week coming, we have 4th of July on Wednesday, the Bible study this coming Wednesday. 22nd is the fellowship, the July fellowship that we'll be having on that Sunday, and then we'll evening worship after morning worship, so the evening worship that evening, and then our 50th celebration, the Bible service on the 24th, 25th, and 26th of August. And also Al is looking for some voices to sing. So if you're interested in singing, doesn't matter, just contact Al and get 3, 4, 5, 6 people together. Our piano and our pulpit, whatever, and sing a joyful noise to the Lord. Those that's 3 nights, Friday night, and Sunday.
Well, I'm looking for joyful noise makers. I'm not worried about quality.
That's what he's doing. Make a joyful noise, and that's what we're looking for as well. These things will be taking place, and will be happening, Lord willing, everything goes okay according to that. Let's all stand this time as our funds and allegiance and opening hymn and opening prayer.
455, I must tell Jesus.
Thank you. Thank you for a song like this. I'm sure that each and every one here truly understands that you're the one to go to. Bless this time, Father, that we've come together. Bless each one to see and be with those that aren't able to be with us, whatever cause may be. Take charge, lead, guide, and reconcile. And I thank the precious name of Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Do we have an old person that has a hymn? Well, I guess she's old enough. Which one? 508? Okay, 508. 508. See, sometimes you got to give these old people a little chance. They're not quite as fast.
Do you even know this song,
baby? Boy, I'm telling you. We're going to let them sing this one solo.
No, we want to song that you know.
We're going to let you, yeah, we're going to let you sing this
one.
Come in and sing this with Miss Allen. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
from there. Just the whole Atlanta.
Ready? No, I said.
I'm just letting it all out.
Oh, anyway, we do want to remember, of course, many, many in prayer, many that are away, many some are traveling, some are away. We remember Bruce and Donnie Armstrong in Oklahoma, remember them in prayer, Renee Bryan in Tennessee, and others as well, and those who are not here with us this morning. The traveling mercies for others as well. Linda has mentioned her daughter and others, remember them in prayer. Milton will be having shoulder surgery on July the 10th. Pray and remember him in prayer as he'll be going through. That's his second operation on that same shoulder as well. So it's devastating the second time around. Now the doctor didn't feel the right person now because he's having complications and problems with it. So it's the second time he's doing it. So remember him in prayer. Others as well, Billy Lynch's granddaughter Nicole was having a hysterectomy this coming Thursday. Remember her in prayer. Lisa is also going to be having a hysterectomy. Remember her in prayer. Both of these ladies, remember them in prayer. Brian with his physical problems, his teeth, and what goes on with him. Remember him in prayer and all that. Miss Hattie Carter, continue to remember Miss Hattie and others in the nursing home. Prayer Thanksgiving, continue to remember Danny Hall and all of others too like him. Remember him in prayer and continual progression that he is making. So continue to remember Danny Hall in prayer. Upcoming August revival and celebration time, remember that in prayer. Pray for that. The upcoming that's coming soon as well. Other prayer requests concerning Thanksgiving, other things that you would like to share with us tonight. Anyone or anything else? Maybe. I mean, I got to know what to pray for. What they pray for? You what? Say the stuff he knows? Oh, okay. I want to make sure you know what to pray for. But yes, he's having allergies, cold, and different other things as well. So remember her in prayer. Also remember Debbie Gary in prayer. Got to push up and down. And her thing can go on with her. Johnny in prayer with that. Us.
Right, can you start taking him on?
I'll try to do it.
Yeah, the dosage right now, we're not sure it's too good. Sugar's still been high.
Okay.
You know, so if I'm in prayer, stand to meet the top of the doctor tomorrow. I'll tell the doctor to see if he wants to increase it right now. I'll wait for him.
Okay.
Remember that prayer.
Sure.
Giving herself the needle.
I'm going to watch for now,
friend. I tell you what, I don't care what they say, that thing's guts is to stick yourself.
Not so hot.
You enjoy it too much.
I remember when my wife was in nursing school and she wanted to practice on me with the needles and everything else, and I told her, no, I don't really like it to be stuck. And yes, here you go, you're going to stick yourself, get yourself in. I don't think so. No, I don't think so. I'm not much into pain. I can take pain, but I'm not into pain.
They let me shoot it in the arm, you eat the arm, you'd be all right.
Yeah, but the arms don't do any good. Yeah. But remember you with that, as far as with your diabetes, and what takes place with that.
Remember my other sister,
absolutely, yes.
Thanks, having a lot of problems right now with her.
Any others? Anyone else? Just continue to remember each other, pray for each other as well. Remember the many things that are going on and taking place in the lives of many, many people and many things that are taking place in and around our community in Slidell, New Orleans, nowhere but the Houston area. Remember everyone and the many things that are taking place. What's going on in the lives of let's go, Lord, in prayer. Almighty God, we come before you tonight, and we just thank you, Lord, that we are able to come here tonight and be here tonight, and we come to glorify, to worship, and praise your name. We thank you, Lord. We don't want to forget, but just always thanking you for your many blessings in spite of all that may be going on in our lives. Health problems, financial problems, work problems, whatever may be going on, Lord, you're in control of all things. And Lord, we just give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. We thank you, Lord, for everything, for all things, even in the midst of all that we may be going through. All that is mine. We just thank you, Lord, for your grace, for your mercy, for your love, and for your help in all of our lives. We thank you. We do lift up in prayer the many, many people that are dealing with different types of physical problems and physical ailments. Be with each and every one. For those that are struggling, those that are going through trials and tribulations, whatever it may be, at work, at home, or within themselves, we lift each and every one of them up to you as well. We pray for those that are traveling on the road, as this is the holiday season for the 4th of July, but also summertime, where a lot of people do take vacations. We lift up each and every one that are traveling, that are on the road, and pray to watch over them, be with them, and help them. Be with those of us who are here, lead us, guide us, and direct us as well. We pray for those in nursing homes and in hospitals. Ms. Hattie Carter, those that will be facing surgery, you will be facing major surgeries, and we pray for each and every one of them, and we lift them up before you as well. We pray for guidance for all of us, as we look to you each and every day of our life, for guidance, for help, for leadership. Be with us, help us in all that we do and all that takes place in all of our lives. Lord, we pray for your guidance and for your help here at Bayou Baptist Church. Pray that you'll help us and continue to be with us, lead us and guide us, and see to the needs of everything that takes place here. We thank you for what you have provided us with and given to us over the years, months, and we just thank you. We lift up in prayer the most important thing is salvation. The salvation of souls. For those who do not know Jesus Christ, friends, family members, co-workers, and even people we have never met, we pray for salvation. For those in need of Jesus Christ in their hearts and in their lives, we pray you'll open their hearts, their eyes, and their ears. We pray for salvation in the lives of those who do not know Jesus. All of this we ask and much more. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Let us continue as we sing unto the Lord.
Have another paper.
Yeah. 147.
Yeah.
You got one, sir? No, you go to straight train class like me.
John Evans.
Who?
Johnny, this is 522.
522? Okay. 522. Let's stand as we turn to 522.
Where you at, baby?
What'd she have? 344. Well, we'll just hang that out. Well, let's go ahead and let that stand. When the morning comes, 522, huh?
He got called out for work. He should be right back then.
That's right. He did. Everybody stand up, so I might as well let's stand up then. Okay, 344. 344.
Yeah, we'll say 522.
Okay. 344. That's 343. Yeah.
I I like it best too. It's an upbeat song.
I felt like I was jogging 2 miles there, 7 miles an hour. Thank you, Mindy.
Pleasure.
Come to Exodus chapter 32, the first 8 verses, looking and thinking on the subject of freedom again, and of course upon God's provisions and how God has provided what God has done, thinking of the things of God, his provisions, his purpose, the past that he has, what he has done, and everything that God has done is for us, delivering us and giving us freedom, and looking at the people of Israel, the people belonging to God. Exodus chapter 32, the first 8 verses. It says, when the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and they said, come, make us gods. Who will go before us? As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him. Then Aaron answered them, take off your gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing, and bring them to me. So all people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they handed him and made into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you out of Egypt. Now when Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord. So the next day the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offering and presented fellowship offering. Afterwards they sat down to eat and drink, and they got up to indulge in revelry. Then the Lord said to Moses, go down, because your people, whom you brought out of Egypt, have become corrupt. They have been quick to turn away from what I commanded them, and have made themselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it, sacrificed to it, and have said, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you out of Egypt. How soon they forget. Moses is on Mount Sinai. They are getting from the Lord God Almighty the Ten Commandments and all of the other laws and stipulations that he wants to give to his people to govern his people. Moses was on Mount Sinai 40 days and 40 nights. Interesting how these things take place and develop as far as the time pattern. Now God had already delivered his people, Israel, from Egypt. God had guided them to Mount Sinai, and God had protected them along the way. God was at work with his nation, the little nation of Israel. He was faithful to the nation, and he was their God. He had displayed his mighty power when they crossed the Red Sea and parted, and there they crossed upon dry land. When they went back, the Egyptians, that when they tried to cross, they were destroyed. God allowed the waters to go over the Egyptians. God provided food and water and enabled them to defeat a countless number of enemies along the way. Now Moses was on Mount Sinai, receiving from God the laws, the stipulations, the commandments. What has happened meanwhile, while Moses is up in the mountain 40 days and 40 nights, people have become impatient. They have begun to grumble. They have begun to complain. Or should I say, they continue to grumble and complain. Because all along the way, it seemed like it's all they've done. Day after day was grumble and complain about something, even though God had provided for them in many things and many ways. And now God tells Moses, your people whom you brought out of Egypt, turned away from me. Yeah, it's always interesting to me when I read what God has told, what God told Moses there in verse 7 and 8, as he tells me, he says, go down to your people. Notice he didn't say go down to my people. He told Moses, go down to your people whom you brought out of Egypt. and how they have become corrupt. And it's always an interesting play on words there of how God would relate that to Moses to say, people have become sinful. But you know, the whole problem is how soon they forget. And what they needed to do is to remember. And like the nation Israel, we too need to remember in our nation as well. Because you see, like the nation Israel, we too need to remember and how soon we too forget. Just to maybe see if anybody knows just for information, how long were the people of Israel in slavery in Egypt? Does anybody remember how long they were in Egypt as slaves? Huh? It was over 400. Yes. It was 430 years that they were enslaved in Egypt. So, this comes out of Exodus chapter 12. You go back there and check. So, 400, it says they were there for 430 years, and then they departed. So, 430 years they were enslaved in Egypt. 430 years. They cried to God for help. 430 years, they were in misery, and there they were at the mercy of them. And so that's the first thing that would come to mind here in verse 1. Notice in verse 1, it says, when the people saw that Moses was so long coming from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, come make us gods, let us go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him. The first thing we need to remember is the past. Even though we don't like to go into the past, we need to reflect upon the past as to remember how and what took place. Remember that for 430 years, they were cruelly, and how they were cruelly treated by the Egyptians, by the taskmaster. How their sons were murdered at birth. Remember, there was a Pharaoh had a decree and said all of the newborn babes born to the Hebrews will be murdered because the Israelites were gaining in popularity, and this frightened Pharaoh. So he had the baby boys at birth, trying to, but God even overplayed all of that. But Moses was one of those that was saved. And we see this. And now with that, constantly for over 400 years, they cried to God for help. Lord, help us. We're in this place with misery and with pain. Here we are at the hands and with slaves to the Egyptians. These people needed to remember what took place in Egypt. They needed to remember what took place for over 400 years when we were there. The time when they were made to work for the Egyptians. The cruel and harsh labor, the killing of their newborn sons, and the cry for deliverance. How soon they forget what it was like back in the past. It wasn't long ago for them. It wasn't that long ago that they were in that same predicament back in Egypt. They knew when they went to Egypt, it was no picnic. It was no holiday. It was slavery. It was misery. It was pain. They had no freedom. None whatsoever. Nothing. How soon they forget. You know, America needs to remember the past as well. We need to remember the past of what is taking place. The courage of our forefathers to take a stand for our independence that we now celebrate. The battle fought. The military odds and the freedom seem to be an impossible dream. Can you imagine? Back there in 1776, or even before that, when all of this was being planned in the minds of just a few handful of people, saying, we no longer want to be under the king, but we want to be a nation of our own, one nation under God. We need to remember how these brave men there dreamed the impossible dream. How they said, we will do this. As I mentioned this morning with John Adams and many others like you, we will fight being God's will. We will do this and give up our lives. George Washington praying at Valley Forge. George Washington, as many historians have said, was a godly man, a Christian man, a man who feared God, the very first president of these United States. And yet, here he prayed at Valley Forge. And through the prayers of him, as well as many others, God granted independence. And thus we became an independent nation, a free nation. One nation under God, indivisible. One nation that was founded under the power of God. How soon we forget. We need to remember the past, and indeed how God, through these men, has given us freedom. Secondly, we need to remember God's provisions. Notice in verse 4. Here, as Moses is a long time coming down, notice what they said to Aaron. Aaron, we need someone else. We need you to make something for us. Come, make us gods, as they said in verse 2. And then Aaron says, take off your jewelry in verse 3. But notice verse 4, as they do this, it says in verse 4, he said, he took what was handed to them, made into an idol, and cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. And they said, these are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt. See, we need to remember God's provisions. It wasn't this calf. It was God's power that provided them the freedom that they had. It was got by God's hand. It was God's miracles that they have, what they have now. God provided a deliverer for the people come out of Egypt after 430 years. Who was it? It was Moses. God called Moses from a burning bush to go and deliver his people. And Moses said, Lord, not me. I can't speak. Why don't you send my brother, or not Aaron, have him speak for me? I can't do this. He gave God all kinds of reasons as to why he could not do it. Yet he went and did it. God sent Moses to deliver his people. Then God brought plagues upon Egypt. One plague after another plague after another plague. Why? To show the nation Egypt and the other nations that the Israelites had come in contact with that their God was an awesome God. And that by his power, there was no God like him. Remember when they went into these different lands after they went into the promised land, they remembered what took place in Egypt in the past and how God sent the plagues to the Egyptians and freed the Israelites. They remembered it and they said, this is the same nation, this is the same God that sent the plagues and what they did to the people of Egypt. God brought the plagues upon Egypt to show his power, that it is by his hand, by his provisions, that he has done things. He opened up the Red Sea. The Red Sea was opened up by the power of God. This was not a fluke. This was not some kind of earthquake or some kind of shifting of the earth to where miraculously and all of a sudden, while the people were there at that particular moment, at that particular time, the Red Sea just opened up, and there they walked across it, like this happened at this particular moment, for no apparent reason, because it was a coincidence. No, this was by the power of God that it opened. When they walked, it said they walked upon dry land. It didn't open, and then they walked upon mud or wet. You ever see something that's really that when water maybe evaporates, but yet it's still not all dry. You walk upon something, it's soggy. But it said in there that it walked, it opened up, it walked upon dry ground. See, when the Lord does stuff, something he does it right. It's all open. And then when the Egyptians tried to come go across, the Lord just closed the sea, showing the power of God. But not only did he do that, but also he brought food. He provided them with manna. And with quail, with food, with water for his people. God provided all that was necessary for them in their journey from Egypt to Mount Sinai, from Mount Sinai to the promised land of Canaan. the promised land. They get to the promised land, all they had to do was step and go across. And they said, no, we can't do that. Can't do it. The people over there are too big. Too many people. We're not able to do it. Even though they sent 12 spies, 10 of them said, can't do it. Two of them, only Joshua and Caleb said, hey, we can do this because the Lord God Almighty is with us. We are able. Let us go over. But all the people, what they do again, they started grumbling and complaining. That whole generation wandered in the desert for 40 years because of lack of faith. They did not believe the power of God. God provided for his people all that was necessary for deliverance. How soon they forget. These same people here, these same people, this generation did not see the promised land except for Joshua and Caleb because they did not remember how God had provided for them. In the same way, God has provided for us as well. Today, I look back over 2 years. I look at this building. I look at people's homes. And I see people have forgotten how God has provided. God has done what God has done. People today have treated God with contempt. They are not honoring God as they should. God has provided for them. God has given them overabundance. And what do we see today in our land? The same thing. People complaining, grumbling. Get on your knees and thank the Lord for what he has done. I tell you, I as a pastor, but also as a minister, but also as a believer, every day I thank God what he has done here in Bayou, what he has done in the homes of many people, but especially what he's done here. Every day I look, and when I see all of these things, even though some things are incomplete, I thank God, because I know it's by the hand of God he has provided for it. I know this. I have no doubt in my mind that the people here complain. We have people today. They forget how God has provided. Not even talking about even some well-meaning Christians. Forget. We need to understand that God gave us the victory through the Revolutionary War. God granted us also the victory. Remember the war between the states, the North and the South, and how it could have separated the United States, but it did not. Even through all that, God even provided for that. God granted the victories even through other wars where these people came and they wanted to invade the U.S. to make it an ungodly nation. But even through all that, God provided the victory. God also provided bountiful harvest, prosperity, and he blessed us abundantly. Do you know how soon we have short memories? Our attention span might be short, I don't know, but how soon people forget that indeed we are greatly blessed and God has greatly provided, and we live in a land where God has displayed his awesome power and he still provides daily, even today. It's true, we may be going through different things in our lives. We may have physical problems. We may have different things that are taking place. God still provides. How soon we forget what people have done even today. They have thrown into the fire and shaped for themselves idols. And said, look what they have done for us. Rather than giving glory and honor to God, they're giving glory and honor to things that are not God. How soon they forget. And then the third thing we see also is the need to remember God's purpose. As I read for you verse 7 and 8 of this year, the need to remember God's purpose. hear God's purposes and they were to be God's people. No longer will they be the people of Egypt or the people there. They were to be God's people. Even though he tells Moses, your people, they were God's people. Now that after they were to be his witnesses and they were to receive from him the promised land. They were a people belonging to God. All of these years as they traveled, God took care of them and they belonged to God Almighty. Not some worthless idol or man-made shape of a calf. Here is God relates to Moses, thinking that God does not see. Now remember, Moses is on the mountain. God is there on the mountain. They're down in the valley. See, sometimes it gets good to be in the mountain. But God's in the mountain with Moses, and then Moses with them, and they're in the valley, and they don't think that God sees all of this, or God understands all of this. And God tells Moses completely, he says, and they have made themselves an idol, cast in the shape of a calf. See, sometimes we think, God doesn't see what we do. He sees all that going on. There is nothing that escapes his eyes. And here, this was a people belonging to him, his nation, and he was bringing them, not just to Mount Sinai, but from there he was bringing them into the promised land. He was going to give them the land that he promised to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, and to their forefathers, to Joseph, as well as to many others. God's purpose for them was to be his people. How soon they forgot. We too, today, we too, God has a purpose for America. A place to worship God freely. We take for granted of how we can come into this place, not just on a Sunday, but we can come any time of the day of the week, open up the doors, and have a worship service. Worship here, where there are other people in other countries that still have to hide in order to worship the one true God. There are other people in other places that wish that they could have the liberty that we have in worshiping God. We take for granted how we need we can worship God. A nation to worship God freely, a place from which missionaries can go to other nations and to other countries to proclaim the gospel. We send hundreds and thousands of missionaries from all denominations to other places from the U.S. to proclaim the gospel, sharing with them the things of this. A nation, again, that would befriend his people, Israel. Today, we are a people belonging to God, but we're a country, we're a people, we need to get back to the basics. How soon we forget. How soon we forget that God is at work in our lives. God has not abandoned us. It may seem like it sometimes because Satan paints that deceiving picture, but God is at work in our lives. The commitments we made to him, we need to commit to him. The vows that we have made to God, we need to continue to make to him regardless of what comes in our lives. The freedom that was gained there at the cross. Jesus died at the cross for a freedom that we now have, the liberty that we now have, the freedom that we have in Christ Jesus. We need to remember God's purpose. Why did God sent his son to die on the cross to give us freedom, to liberate us from the power of sin. God accomplished the purpose. Whether anybody or nobody believes it, that was done. God, through his son Jesus Christ, died for our sin. And through him is true freedom, as I mentioned this morning. And God's purpose was that we are to be a free people, a people belonging to God. Today, we might be a minority, but we, so were the Israelites, so was George Washington and the other men that served and made this country free, that fought to bring our freedom. But like these people, we too need to give an alliance and allegiance to God and to Him alone. Do not make unto thee any graven images. Do not make unto thee any idols. What they're doing here was wrong. This was not God's purpose for them. God's purpose for them was to be His people. We need to be a people belonging to God and only to Him. To worship Him and Him only. None of God has truly blessed us. Let us give allegiance to God through Christ for His power, for His provision, and for His purpose in our lives. And what is our purpose? It's to glorify God. Give Him glory, praise, and the honor. God bless the reading of His word. Let's all speak. Almighty God, we come before You tonight again. We thank You. We praise You. We glorify You. We thank You, Lord, for all that You have given to us. Thank You. How soon we forget. Help us, Lord, not to forget, but always to remember. Remember the past and what we were and who we are now. Help us to remember Your many, many provisions. How You have provided for us in the past and even today. And help us, Lord, to remember that indeed our purpose in life is to bring glory and honor to You. Be with us, lead us, and guide us. In the name of Jesus, amen. I pray that if God has spoken to you today, whether here or you looking at this on Facebook or YouTube, you need further counseling, or if you would like to talk to someone and you live locally here, you can call at the church at 985-214-9343. And feel free to call, but if you're out of town or if you don't live near here, seek your local pastor or minister and talk to them further about your own eternal life. We only have today. So if you would like to seek or to talk to someone, feel free to call us and let us know if we can help you in your eternal life, your salvation, your relationship with the Lord as well.